Let's say you want to analyze a bunch of things like files, strings, or whatever, but you also want to let the user pause, resume, or even stop the analysis. To do that, you need to run multiple pieces of code at the same time. In today's video, I'm going to teach you the basics of threading and also give you a real-world example that you're going to use in the future. So first of all, we need to import the threading module and also time, because we're going to need that later on. Now we need to define the function that we want the thread to run. Okay, so def thread, let's call it like that, then print starting, then exiting, and here in the middle, our time does leap 3 seconds. Okay, just to pretend we're doing something. Then we need to create a new thread object, and we pass the function as the target key argument. So my thread is equal to threading dot thread target. We need to pass the function, only the function object, so we don't want to call it. We just need the without the parentheses. Okay. Then to check if a thread is alive or not, we just need to use the isAlive method. Okay. And here this should return false because this is not alive, because to actually start the thread, we need to call the start method like that. And here we can call it again and we can do something like my thread is alive. Okay. So if you run that, you'll see that false starting true. And then after 3 seconds exiting. So as you can see, it starts out false, then the thread starts and this is printed. And even though this thread is actually waiting for the time leap, the main thread, which is this one, prints the true here. And then after 3 seconds, you've got the exiting. So the main thread is not actually blocked by the other thread, by the time leap on the other thread. But if we use join here, this is not the case anymore. Why? Because join basically blocks the calling thread, which is the main thread, with where we print this, okay? Until the thread that called join terminates. In this case, this. So as long as this is running, the main thread is basically blocked. As you can see, false starting, exiting, false. Why? Because in this case, this is printed, false, then starting, this thread starts, then this is blocked, so this is not running, this prints exiting, and now the thread terminates. So this code, the main thread, is actually unlocked, let's say that, and this is printed. And this is false, of course, because now this terminated. Okay, perfect. Of course, you can pass argument to the thread function. So if you wanted to have like one argument here, one, then two, three, for example, you cannot do something like that. Okay, you need to pass the args tuple like that, and here you can write whatever you want. You can put a variable in there, but in this case I'm just going to write two strings like that. And also you can have keyword arguments, but in this case you need a dictionary. Let's do something like three, third, something like that. Okay. In this case, one is going to be first, two is going to be second, and three is going to be third. Really, really important, these two variables in the function definition could be called whatever, because these are normal arguments, but the three needs to match the three here. So if this were to be 3, 1, something like that, here you would need to write 3, 1. Otherwise, that would throw an error. Okay, so just keep that in mind. And if you just want one element here, you cannot do something like that, but you need to write the comma as well. You need to have this here. Otherwise, this will throw an error as well. Okay. So now let's comment this out and let's start talking about how you can communicate between threads using threading events. Okay. Threading events are basically objects with internal flags that you can set to true or false. Okay. The cool thing is that these are shared between all the threads and you can use them to stop a thread, etc., etc. So threading event is created by using threading event, something like that, really, really easy. You can set the flag, the internal flag, to true by using set, or you can clear it, so set it to false with clear. And also you can see the status of the internal flag by using isSet, which returns true if the internal flag is true, or false if it's false. Really, really easy. Then also there's another method you can use, which is wait. And the wait basically stops the code as long as the flag is false. When the flag becomes true, because you set it to true, it lets the code carry on. Okay, really, really cool. I'm going to use all of these things in one little example to show you everything better, okay? So let's say that you have a bunch of things to analyze and you loop through them one by one, but you also want the user to be able to stop, pause, or resume the operation, okay? So you could do something like pause, resume, event is equal to threading, event, okay? Then stop, event is equal to threading event again. So you've got two events. Then you want the function where you analyze the things. So analyze things. Then for, let's do x in range 1000. So you say you've got 1000 things, for example, files or whatever. So if stop event is set, then we want to print exiting, to space, and then we want to return. So basically, if when we set the stop event later on to true, we want to exit, so this returns and the operation is stopped and the thread terminates. But if you don't want it to stop, we can use pause room wait like that, then print exit, and then time sleep to slow a little bit things down, 0.2. So here we are just waiting, okay, for the pause resume event to be true. So here I've used the is set because I want to do one thing if this is set and one another thing if this is not set. Here I just want to wait, so I just need wait. So then I'm going to create my thread. So threading, thread, target, analyze things like this. And then I can start the thread straight away. Okay, start, perfect. Then I can print to the user something like enter, P2, pause, resume. Then I can do something like enter, X2, stop. And then the input, press enter to start, which is the first thing the user needs to do. Then after the user presses enter, you can set the pause resume event to true. So you can just set it. So this here, the code starts running because this is now true. Then we can use a while true loop to keep asking the user for a command. So user command input. Then if the user command is equal to X, we want to the stop event to become true so that here this is true and then we return, we exit, and here we want to exit, right? If the user command is equal to P, in this case we want to pause. So if pause resume event is set, we need to check if this is set. This means that the code is running, so we want to clear it, set the internal flag to false. So the wait here stops the code. Then we want to do something like time sleep 0.3 seconds, and then print little thing like that. So here we do something like post, okay. Here I stopped the code for 0.3 seconds, so I'm sure the code above has stopped. Otherwise, sometimes a number can be printed after the paused message and it doesn't look great, okay? So here, else, so if the pause resume event is false in this case, which means that we're already waiting, we can print the same thing. So actually do something like this. And here, resumed. Then we are going to wait 0.3 seconds, Here maybe it's not necessary, but it doesn't hurt anyone. So, and then we can try to run it. Of course, here I'm using just two threads, but you can use as many as you wish and as many as you need, of course. Let's try to run it. So let's do something like this. Okay. So enter P to pause, press enter to start, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. P, enter, paused. P, enter, resumed. X, enter, exiting. Okay. Perfect. So now on the screen, you should see another video about Python. You should go and watch it, because if you're still watching this one, you're going to enjoy that one as well.